Good morning. I look out there and I kind of expect to see a dance circle. So it's a little weird to see this set up with chairs, but we're excited that even after last night's festivities, that all of you are here for our exciting show this morning. We've got a lot of great, amazing people on stage. And I'd like to start that with Karenann Terrell. So Karenann Terrell, the word that I think of when I think of Karenann is pioneer. She has been a pioneer in the technology space. She started out as an engineer and then worked her way up and went on to lead some of the most significant, largest leadership positions at the world's largest companies, from being the CIO of Walmart to now being the Chief Digital and Technology Officer at GSK, which is one of the largest global companies in the world. So from all of us that you've been an inspiration to in the technology field, thank you.
Makes me feel old. Thank you.
Pioneer is not synonymous for old.
All right, I'll take that as neutral.
Okay, so Karenann, Aaron has talked a lot on stage yesterday about skills development. There's been a ton of breakouts, a lot of conversations. As a CIO, how should other either CIOs or aspiring CIOs, CTOs, think about skills development in their teams?
I think that despite technologists, where, you know, hang with me, technologists, we're not the best with people. People are the most important part of any change that's happening. And the digital revolution, whether you're in the retail business, the media business, the drug business, is changing companies massively. And whatever the priorities are strategically in the business model of the company, it has to include the transition of capabilities of the people. Because the way you think and act in a digitized world where it's very, very fast, the pace is beyond anything that we've ever dealt with before, and the skill capabilities are brand new in the area of technology, it actually has to be on the top of your priority list that you are working on skill capability. What are the right roles that you have in the organization, and what are the capabilities that are going to be delivering the strategy of the company? It's no longer technology as a support function. It is technology of a driver, as a driver of the business strategy. So skills is the only thing that really will have the ability to keep you working at pace and be a differentiator.
So, you know, as these companies are going through transformation, like you just said, the skills and the transformation of skills are going to get us there. How should folks be thinking about budget and investment and resources on the skilling of their teams?
So I was meeting with our HR leader at GlaxoSmithKline, and we were having a conversation about the investments that we make in people. And is it easier to hire people from the outside and take the risk that they don't understand our culture and they really don't understand our business, or reskill? And you know, her question was, should we enhance our capability? And I said, we're not thinking about that right. It actually needs to be a business decision. Would you go to the head of R&D and say, biology is changing? Let's have a learning platform conversation about skills migration. No, it would be a business conversation about how we actually, what the biologists, chemists need to do. That's the exact same conversation that has to take place when you have a budget conversation or you have a priority conversation about skills and technology, because technology is becoming the driver of every business. Mm-hmm. Nobody thought that the taxi business would be driven by technology. I would tell you, pre-Uber, I was thinking, you know, I just wish that the back seat was a little cleaner. I just didn't have that orientation that Uber...
That would have been your upgrade?
That Uber could completely blow my mind in a new model. And that's what the digital side of things are, is people are the actual supply chain of innovation when you think of digital. I stole that shamelessly from Nate that people are the supply chain, and we have to start acting like that as technologists in companies.
So it's wonderful because that resonates with some of the conversation Aaron had yesterday with, you know, your tech strategy is your corporate strategy. In that conversation with the head of HR or working with your counterpart on people teams at any organization, how has that partnership been? And do you feel like it is a partnership, or is it really need to be the tech leader driving it, or can HR drive it? How has that worked for you over time?
Truthfully, I've seen two models. One is tech leaders that know that things have to change, that have HR partners that they've allocated that change to as a priority, and tech leaders that know that their priority includes people transformation who are partnered with HR.
Okay.
And to use the commentary yesterday about leaders and laggards, leaders are in that second model. Mm. Leaders are in the one where, as a chief technologist, as someone who is focusing on the transformation through technology of companies, you need to have it on your priority list, and you need to be in partnership with HR, because if HR has been allocated that priority, how will they know what investments to make or what to stop doing or what the right mix of hiring from the outside is for skills versus skilling up possibilities? So I think that you have to get HR to be a partner. You cannot allow them to have the leadership role in all of that, because training technical people is a different science than training people on the fundamentals of finance, or what are the compliance goals of the organization, or management fundamentals. This is the business of engineering, computer science, and data and analytics when you get to issues of security, and I think that this is a different matter, and leaders know that.
Good. On that note, when you had the conversation around do we reskill, do we hire in, once you have this amazing team that you've built, whether you reskilled them or you had to hire some in, how do you retain your talent? Like, as a leader, we've had a lot of conversations, a really interesting one just now backstage, about how high-performing teams work. How do you retain that amazing talent so that you can keep that high-performing team?
So how many of you in the audience are those technologists that your boss is trying to retain? Hands up. Lots. So if I'm wrong, boo me.
Because I boo her.
No, because I think this is a fundamental question. Technologists, in a world where there are hundreds of thousands of openings for you to do what you do in data and analytics, in security, as in the DevOps world, as a networking engineer, where there are hundreds of thousands of jobs open, I believe, as a technologist, so you know, N of one, need to be treated as if the work that they are doing is fundamental to the business. I think second, they need to work for businesses, and they want to work for businesses with missions, so that at a personal level, what I do every day for 8 hours, it's probably 12 for most of you, 12 hours a day matters. And I have to be in a place where I can drive my own mastery of the skills. Some people drive that harder than others. You know, when I worked at Cadillac, I had to know absolutely everything about the competitive set. I read, I thought about it day and night. You know, my poor son, he didn't get nearly the mind share that he should have in those days. But I think that was just me as a technologist trying to get to mastery in skills. I want to be able to, in a competitive way, as well as in a self-motivated way, get to be a master in what I have chosen. I believe that technologists know that they'll get paid more when that happens. And they'll be involved in work that matters more if they're working for companies that really do matter. And I think that there's a self-satisfaction that the job that they have picked for the world, the job that they have picked for themselves in the world, that they are able to get to that level of achievement that they have the ambition for. So I think mastery and being in a place that's very mission-driven and really playing that up and allowing people to be a part of that is what retains the best people. It's a formula that has worked for me and for us when I was at Baxter, when we were at Mercedes, when we were at Walmart, certainly, because we were working in a place called Bentonville, Arkansas. I'm sure that's the garden spot of America, but to get the best technologists, they can't just work for Walmart. You know, we were selling bananas. That's what our mission was. We were feeding the hungry. We were moving in that direction, but they have to matter, and they have to be able to master their own universe.
And I don't know if I can still call myself a technologist. I started out as a developer many, many years ago.
Just do it.
I'm going to. But those things are important to me. I mean, it's why I joined Pluralsight, was the mission of this company. And, you know, I crave mastery. I think we all crave mastery. So that's a really good...
You're busting my myth that technologists aren't like other people. But I'm going to include you in the technologists.
Okay, I want to switch gears a little bit. You've talked to me about... the CIO Strategy Exchange. And I'm a bit enamored with this group because it feels like this secret society that's a little Illuminati-esque. So can you tell us a little bit about this group?
No, I can't. Fantastic. That's awesome.
It's just me and you having a conversation. There's no social media going on.
2,000 of our friends.
Yeah. Can you tell us a little bit about this group and maybe a key insight that you've gained from it?
The CIO Strategy Exchange is a group of 44 of what I think are the top thought leaders in technology. Most of them are in big companies, but not all of them are in the biggest companies. And it's an invitation-only group. You can get kicked out if your thought leadership doesn't level up on par. But it, in that leader laggards, I think that it's a closed cohort and forum around which the direction of technology and what's happening at companies can be discussed without the influence of technology vendors. So it is, an example is the woman that led all of Dow's technology moved to Intel, and she was out.
Oh.
Because technologists, so that there's no advocacy of technology inside, that it's a small group conversation. And I think the smartest things that I ever applied to the companies that I worked for, I got from those colleagues. There was really, really brutal, courageous conversations about what was working and what wasn't. Many of those in the group have been fired for their courage.
Oh, wow.
They show up other places because they're really smart. But and I think that they do two things enormously well. They focus on people all the time. They know that there is never any single individual in a company, as visionary as they may be as individuals, that can actually lift the company sustainably. So they focus on people development around them all the time. And secondly, they cast their vision impossibly forward in time, impossibly forward, so that they know whether they are on track with the technology architecture, the decisions that they are making and their priorities, that they are headed towards the North Star. They never pick the calendar year. They never pick the three-year arc of strategy. And even things that we thought were impossible 10 years that they were talking about were reality 5 years ago.
So I think that a couple lessons for me is that this amazing group is focused on the people.
Yeah.
So that's a great takeaway.
Sure.
And that each of us, I'm sitting here thinking, I should have a group like this. We should all find the best in our roles, the thought leaders, the visionaries, and work with them, because you learn from that. Yeah. So I'm going to wrap with one final question. You are a member of the Pluralsight board.
I am.
And Karenann has been invaluable in her time. Her voice, your expertise, your experience has been invaluable for discussions and setting our strategy. Can you tell me a little bit about why you, I know why we wanted you, but why did you join the board?
Do y'all know that commercial, The Hair Club for Men? Like, it worked so well, I bought the company. We used Pluralsight. People are the most important thing when you're transitioning a company at Walmart scale, because scale transition is a lot harder than the first moves that you make. And Pluralsight is in a segment of one in that digital transformation. And although I didn't exactly foresee that there would be this spectacular IPO, and it's been a little more work than I thought, but...
keep her busy. We keep her busy.
I want to matter, and I want to work at companies and with people who want to matter, and Pluralsight matters. And like you, I want that to be with the best and one that's going to be here sustainably in order to change the world. Digital transformation is my drug of choice for the rest of my career, and Pluralsight is a big player in that arena. So it's as simple as that. And I love the people. I love Aaron. His vision, the team that he puts around him, is inspirational to me. And it teaches me in an orthogonal way how to be a better tech leader at a drug company in London, England.
Excellent. Well, Karenann, thank you for sharing your wisdom today. I know I learned a lot. And thank you for everything you do with Pluralsight and the tech community.
Thank you very much. All right, great. Thanks a lot. Thank you.